Before we start, if we could all just bow our heads for a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, please send your Holy Spirit to be here with us in this place. We are in need of your grace and of your love and of your forgiveness. Please, Lord, open our minds to what it is you want us to know about what the enemy is trying to do in terms of capturing our minds. Send angels to be in this place, because there's going to be a battle in the minds of many here, and we need your Holy Spirit to guide us in these matters. I pray this in the name of Jesus. In your name, amen. It was mid-1862, and General Lee had just taken Maryland. The Southern troops were crushing the Northern troops, and it was General McClellan that led his army up to Maryland to meet General Lee. And as they were marching, one of his soldiers sat down to take a rest, and there in the mud was an envelope. And he picked up this envelope, and inside the envelope were three cigars and the battle plans of General Lee. How many know this story? There's a few. All right, this was known as the turning point of the Civil War. You can imagine the excitement of the Northern troops all of a sudden having in their possession the battle plans of the enemy. This is very much how my brother Scotty and Brandon and I feel that we have been shown the battle plans of the enemy. And that's why we've entitled this seminar Battlefield Hollywood for that very reason. We feel that this is a battlefield for our minds. And our scripture that we use as our motto is, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. I think that God doesn't want us to be ignorant to the devices of Satan, and that's why we are focusing on this during these talks. Because you see, my brother and I especially, we were under the power of sorcery, and we didn't even know it. There was a spell that was cast upon us that put us to sleep spiritually. The master sorcerer himself was behind all this, and we didn't even really know it. You know, from a very young age, we were enchanted by the things that were coming out of Hollywood. Walt Disney, of course, most of his movies are about the occult. He was a 33rd degree Freemason himself and was in a religion that he was very conscious of, knowing the fact that he was in a religion that worshiped Lucifer by name. In Revelation 18:23, where it's talking about the end of the fall of Babylon, and the light of the candle shall shine no more at all in thee, and the voice of the bridegroom shall not be heard at all no more in thee. For the merchants were the great men of the earth, and for by thy sorceries were all nations deceived. My brother and I were deceived by sorcery. You saw on Sabbath afternoon, those of you who were here, we're dealing with occultism at its highest level. The entertainment industry is leading a rebellion against God. We believe that to our core because we were raised Seventh-day Adventists. We were taught these things as children, and yet we still totally went away from the church. How is that? Well, there was a spell that was put upon us. This word sorcery in this text here, it's amazing. The Bible's amazing how you can just look at one little word and it opens up so much more knowledge to us. In the Strong's Concordance, the Greek root word is pharmakia, which we get our English word pharmacy. So look at the definitions here. The use or administering of drugs, poisoning, all right, this is sorcery. It's magical arts, often found in connection with idolatry and fostered by it. So we could kind of wrap these all up together and say, anything that medicates our minds so that we cannot follow the will of God, and the will of God is to worship and follow His laws, would be considered sorcery. So let's look at the mind for a moment. Neil Nedley writes a book, Proof Positive. Any of you have this book, Proof Positive? Good, good. This is an excellent book, excellent source for all the things that medicate our minds so that we can't follow the will of God. Our brains, a third of them, are what we call the frontal lobe. Okay, this is the part of your brain that's right up here in the front of your forehead. It's the seat of our spirituality, our morality, and our will. That God-given gift that He's given each of us to choose between right and wrong. So it would be very important to understand anything that would hinder this vital command center. Right? We know that the mark of the beast is written on the forehead. We know that the name of God is written on the remnant church, the end time church. This is His character, is in our minds right here. That's why it's symbolized by a mark on the forehead. This is what sets us apart from the rest of the animal kingdom. A dog has about 7% of his brain being frontal lobe, and a cat has about 3.5%. That's why dogs are more lovable than cats. Kind of puts that dog is man's best friend, right? Not to put down the cats. The cats still have 3.5%. But this is what sets us apart from the animal kingdom. The cognition that we have in our frontal lobe is a very powerful thing, and we need to be very careful with anything that would hinder this vital command center. In 1 Corinthians 3:16, it says, "Know ye not that you are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you?" Where does God dwell within us? In our minds. In our minds. He doesn't dwell in my arms. He's not in my legs. He dwells in our minds, in our hearts. Okay? That's where God dwells. Spirit of Prophecy tells us in Acts of the Apostles, page 518, those who would not fall a prey to Satan's devices must guard well the avenues to the soul. They must avoid reading, seeing, or hearing that which will suggest impure thoughts. The mind must not be left to dwell at random upon every subject that the enemy of souls may suggest. The heart must be faithfully sentineled, or evils without will awaken evils within, and the soul will wander in darkness. Guarding the avenues to our mind. One of the major ways that lets down our guard is hypnosis. Just look at the classical definition here out of the Encyclopedia of Hypnosis, and we're going to refer back to this definition, so keep these things in your mind. Hypnosis is a mental state of heightened suggestibility, characterized by a trance-like sleep. It is variously achieved by repetition of instructions in a low-level voice, or by having the subject fix his gaze upon a light in an otherwise dark room. Testimonies to the Church, volume 8, page 293, tells us this. In the future, Satan's superstitions will assume new forms. Errors will be presented in a pleasing and flattering manner. False theories, clothed with garments of light, will be presented to God's people. Thus, Satan will try to deceive, if possible, the very elect. Most seducing influences will be exerted. Minds will be hypnotized. All right, she saw this way back in her time. She saw this happening. She saw all the way down to our time that Satan would use amazing things to deceive God's people. So why is hypnosis a bad thing? Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 6:12 that all things are lawful for me, but all things are not helpful. all things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. You see, hypnosis is giving over your willpower to the hypnotist. It is letting down your guard so that somebody else can strongly suggest things to your mind. And it works. People have undergone open heart surgery. No pain, just hypnosis. Women having childbirth pain-free, just undergoing hypnosis. Someone comes into the hypnotist and says, "Hey, I can't quit smoking. Will you please strongly suggest to my brain that I shouldn't smoke any longer? I don't have the willpower to do it." So you undergo hypnosis, and what they do is, through repetitious instructions, they suggest to your brain that smoking they attach emotions, basically, to the act of smoking. So that when you go to pick up a cigarette, you feel all these negative emotions that they have now attached to the act of smoking. Here's what's happening in your brain when you undergo hypnosis. There are these different brain states, mental conditions that our brains are naturally in, okay? These are all just natural states that your brain is in. There's the delta wavelength, that's when you're in deep sleep. The theta wavelength, when you're in light sleep, when you're in REM sleep and you're dreaming, there's a little bit of activity going on there. When you awake and you're awake but relaxed, this is alpha state. Beta is you're awake and you're excited. When you undergo hypnosis, it locks you in to alpha brainwave patterns. When you take certain drugs, it locks you in to alpha brainwave patterns. Listen to what Lori Cobalt says in a book called Power of the Witch. "The science of witchcraft is based on the ability to enter an altered state of consciousness we call alpha. In alpha, the mind opens up to non-ordinary forms of communication, such as telepathy, clairvoyance, and precognition. Here, we also may experience out-of-body sensations and psychokinesis, or receive mystical visionary information that does not come through our five senses. In alpha, the rational filters that process ordinary reality are weakened or removed, and the mind is receptive to non-ordinary realities. Alpha is the springboard for all psychic and magical workings. It is the heart of witchcraft. You must master it before proceeding on to any other spell or ritual or exercise in this book." Mystics in every religious tradition speak of alpha states of consciousness and the lure of divine light, although they do not do so in their own, although they do so in their own metaphors and images. In their own ways, they have learned how to enter alpha as they pray and worship. They learn how to become enlightened. There's a lot of truth in what she's saying. I mean, she's coming from the other side, saying that this is the heart of witchcraft. Satan knows that. That's why he's using this state of mind. It's the state of mind, it's our eye of faith. Ellen White talks about the eye of faith. The occult world calls it your third eye, and that your third eye must be open to be enlightened. Okay? Satan is exploiting this mental state. So what's happening in your brain when you watch television? Remember the definition. That last part is hypnosis can be induced by staring at a light in an otherwise dark room. So that's what we're doing. When we watch television, you're sitting there staring at a light source that's flickering at you at 30 frames a second, and you are going into a semi-hypnotic state within seconds. There's tons of research done on this, and scientists have found that even if there's no images, even if you just flash a blinking light at somebody, you can induce a hypnotic state. The other thing that happens, we have this left and right brain situation happening. Your left side of your brain is your analytical, critical, logical side of your brain. It compartmentalizes the information coming in. It's sifting and it's filtering through what's coming in. And it's a very important side of your brain. The right side of your brain is also important. It's in control of your emotions and your aesthetic and your dreamy side. We should be using our whole brain when we're doing things. But when you watch television, an interesting thing happens. Your brain switches from predominantly all brain thinking to right brain thinking. So basically, the left side of your brain shuts down. You are no longer able to critically analyze the information that's coming into you through your senses. And when that switchover happens, the body releases a rush of endorphins. These are the body's natural opiates. It hooks up to the same receptor sites in every cell in your body as does opium or heroin. So now, the definition of sorcery, pharmakia, we're dealing with something that is a very powerful drug. You become addicted to your body's own natural opiates when you watch television. And if you watch television, if you watch a lot of television, try stopping instantly. There's been many studies where they've done where people watch lots and lots of television and then they stop. And they go through the same withdrawal symptoms as does someone coming off of heroin. They have headaches, insomnia, irritability, because you've become addicted to your body's own natural opiates. Within seconds, this rush of endorphins takes place. And it didn't happen because you just went and jogged for 45 minutes. Right? The runner's high, that's where you exercise, and at the end of that exercise, your body releases endorphins. Okay? This is an unnatural release of endorphins into your system, and you become addicted to it. So basically, what we have here is the opiate of the masses. That's what the television is. It's the home hypnotist. And I think, I mean, even if we're watching 3ABN or we're watching, you know, some religious video, I think that we should have our Bibles there with us and we should break our concentration and not be staring at that light source constantly, be checking everything against the Word. Check it. Because when you're watching television, your critical analytical side of your brain is not working. You're unable to filter the information coming into your system. It comes in all at one chunk. This quote, I found this in Neil Nedley's book there, Proof Positive. He was quoting Neil Postman, a professor at NYU that has a whole curriculum he calls Media Ecology, where he's studying the effects of television on society and all these things that are happening in society based upon all the technologies and media that we're exposed to on a daily basis. He's very much against the television. He says, the horror of television is that the information goes in, but we don't react to it. It goes right into our memory pool, and perhaps we react to it later, but we do not know what we are reacting to. When you watch television, you are training yourself not to react. So later on, you're doing things without knowing why you're doing them or where they're coming from. You see, two things are happening. You are training yourself not to react. When you're sitting there watching something and you see someone about to kill somebody on a TV show or in a movie, do you jump up and you say, hey, don't kill that guy? No. You don't, because you know that it's not real. And so you sit there and you don't react. Yet your brain is being tricked because part of it is saying, hey, something's really happening. That's why you feel those emotions and that anxiety when something bad is about to happen. And so then when you're out in the real world and something bad is happening, you don't react because you've trained yourself not to react. The other thing, you're reacting to things and not even knowing really why you're reacting to them. And there's a business out there that knows this to a T. It's the advertising industry. They know that if they can get us to react based upon our feelings, you see, remember how the definition of hypnosis, right? They're attaching emotions to their product. That's what the advertising industry does. And so then you're out there in the real world and you see an icon or this or that, and if you've seen that enough times, you're going to react. They know that. They've spent millions and they make billions. The numbers are staggering, what the advertising industry spends and then what they get in return. And this is one of the most studied areas in science. In the last decade, there's been over 3,000 scientific studies. 500 books have been written on the effects of television and the brain. But we're not going to hear about it on TV. You're going to have to look and you're going to have to dig. Don't just take my word for it. Study these things for yourself. Just type in to the internet, what are the effects of television on the brain, and you'll get a bunch of stuff that comes up. Find some of these books. You know, Neil Nedley's book is a great one. Okay, I'm going to show you this clip here where they are, we put together a bunch of different ads where they're kind of laughing at in our face that they're using hypnosis and subliminal advertising to sell you products.
Welcome to subliminal advertising. Don't worry, it will only affect your brain.
In 5 seconds, your eyes widen to capture the rush of color. In 12 seconds, you begin to see detail within the details. In 23 seconds, your brain begins to question what is real. Regza LCD TV in 1080p Full HD from Toshiba. Experience it for yourself, and in 29 seconds or less, you'll see why Regza is the one to watch.
Okay.
A big bacon cheeseburger made fresh.
Right, but a talking gecko, why?
I'll tell you why. Because people trust advertising icons. Some bloke tells you to go to geico.com and you're like, really? And just who might you be? But a gecko, he can be trusted.
Hey, have you heard about the crazy new way to send a message today? It flashed on a screen too quick to see, but still you get it subliminally.
Subliminal advertising complete.
Notice how at the end of commercials there's always that ding, you're free to move about the country. It's always the same. It's a repetitious thing that's always in your mind, that these catchphrases and things that they attach to their products. In 23 seconds, your brain begins to question what is real. You know? Why do we sit there and watch these things? Why is it so alluring to sit there and go, oh man, I'm in space with Captain Kirk? Are you really in space with Captain Kirk? No, that the sets and the things, were there's somebody behind a door opening and closing that electric door that they have. It's so fake, it's crazy that we believe these things. You know, even though we know it's fake, we sit there and we watch it. Here's a simple example of how layered these things can be and you don't even realize it. Everybody's heard that sex sells. Here's an advertisement, let's say, that is blaring sex at you. Can you see it? Can you see what's sexual about this picture? Once I show you, you'll never not see it. It's the word sex written right there in the plants. And when I take it away, you're always going to see it. And every time you see this picture from now on, you're always going to see it. So there's things that we don't see. This, it's so layered and so complex, it's really hard to decipher through the information that's coming at you in terms of what they're doing in advertisement, you know. They do, I've seen examples of this in Walt Disney movies where in the cloud the word sex is written. Phallic symbols in buildings and this and that. Things that you just don't catch, but somehow our minds are picking that up because they're attaching the emotion of sex to their product, because we all equate sex with pleasure. And so they know that if they can get us to react based upon our feelings and make decisions based upon our feelings, they can sell us anything. Because you're not making decisions based upon principle, you're making decisions based upon feeling. It's all about feelings. Feeling, it's a feeling-based system. Here's a 1980s campaign for Pepsi. There's sex written on the side of the cans when they're stacked up. And it was in the 70s that they said subliminal advertising, this is illegal, but there's no way to regulate this. It's layered. It's beyond what we can comprehend. Here's the facts. 99% of every household owns a television. Is there anybody in here that does not own a television? Amen. There's a few. Right on. All right? The average hours watched are about 6 hours, 47 minutes a day. And this is on the low end of the averages. We found averages even higher than this. Let's start adding these numbers up. 47 hours, 48 minutes a week. 2 solid months a year. By the time you're 65 years old, if you keep this rate up, you'll have watched 9 solid years of television. That's not 9 years, 8 to 5, that's 9 solid years. And people talk about not having enough time. I don't have enough time. I don't have enough time to read the Bible or to pray. Here's 9 solid years. Imagine what we could do with that extra time if we put this down. When I started working in television about 7 years ago, I don't know why, but for some reason, my wife and I, we put the TV away. She had a little television, and we actually gave it to a friend, and we no longer had a television. And it was amazing. I just stopped watching television. All of a sudden, I had all this time to do other things, and I thought about this many times after. Man, what? I have no time to watch television. I've got all these other things to do. So, you know, I don't know. But I was still heavily addicted to movies. And it wasn't until I really started coming back to the truth and to church and saw Ivor Myers Out of the Black Hole or Escape from the Black Hole that I really realized, man, I need to put this down and I need to put it down completely. And you know the story of Gideon, when he went to fight the enemy, the first thing that God asked him to do was what? Tear down the idol that your father set up. Tear down the idol. Now you can attack your enemy. There were so many things in my life that I was still grappling with that I wasn't able to see and I wasn't able to fight with until I set this idol down. And when I set the idol down, then all of a sudden, you know, I started praying and I said, Lord, please show me. What do you want me to do? What do you want me to know? And let me just say, when you start praying prayers like that, when you start asking God, what do you want me to do? Be prepared to be answered. Because he will. He'll answer. And all of a sudden, all this information started coming into us. Someone up in our hometown asked us, hey, why don't you guys come up and talk to these kids at a youth rally about Hollywood. We didn't put this together because we wanted to. We were asked to do this. And all these things just came to us. And by no means is this something that we put, all this information, none of this is new light. It's all out there. And we just have compiled it into this presentation format. Again, to talk about how advertising works, so what the most advertised product on TV, what do you think it is? And not just one product, kind of think of a genre of products. Fast food. Fast food is the most advertised product on television. It incorporates everything from soft drinks to candy bars to all our fast food restaurants. And look at what our country is suffering from. Obesity, almost at the rate of 60%. It's an epidemic. I remember Scott telling me, he when he used to watch television a lot, those commercials for the new sandwich at Jack in the Box or whatever, it would just get to him. And then before you know it, he said he'd be in the car and he'd be driving down to Jack in the Box to get the new sandwich, you know? So for some of us, it doesn't work that way, but some of us it does. Little children are the most susceptible to these things because they have a really hard time deciphering between what's real and what's not real. And I found some studies that actually put out a warning. Any child under the age of 2 should not be exposed to television at all. None. No TV. I don't care if it's Baby Einstein or whatever those things are. None of that. Because the neuroconnectivity in a young child's brain is still so loose. It's still trying to figure out, this is mom, this is dad, this is how life works. And you throw television in the mix, and it short circuits that wiring, and it is the leading cause of attention deficit disorder. Think about it. A problem paying attention. A problem paying attention to the teacher up front who's just talking. A problem paying attention to the pastor who's just up front preaching. A problem paying attention to just lifeless words on a page. because they're not going bing, sip, boo, tsh, ba, making all these noises and flashing colored lights at them and everything. I'm not saying it's the only cause, but it is one of the major causes. This is a clip from the documentary called The Corporation, in which it talks about the pervasiveness of advertising and how it's focused at children. And I'll let you watch this here.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Off into space. Man, that takes real teamwork. And here's a team of junior spacemen with an out-of-this-world breakfast.
Comparing the marketing of yesteryear to the marketing of today is like comparing a BB gun to a smart bomb. It's not the same as when I was a kid, or even when the people who are young adults today were kids. It's much more sophisticated and it's much more pervasive. It's not that products themselves are bad or good. It's the notion of manipulating children into buying the products. In 1998, Western International Media, Century City, and Lieberman Research Worldwide conducted a study on nagging.
We asked parents to keep a diary for 3 weeks and to record every time, you could imagine, every time their child nagged them for a product. We asked them to record when, where, and why.
This study was not to help parents cope with nagging. It was to help corporations help children nag for their products more effectively.
Anywhere from 20% to 40% of purchases would not have occurred unless the child had nagged their parents. That is, we found, for example, a quarter of all visits to theme parks wouldn't have occurred unless a child nagged their parents. 4 out of 10 visits to places like Chuck E. Cheese would not have occurred. And any parent would understand that. You know, when I think of Chuck E. Cheese, oh my goodness, it's noise. And there's so many kids, why would I want to spend 2 hours there? But if the child nags enough, you're going to go. We saw the same thing with movies, with home video, with fast food. You can manipulate consumers into wanting and therefore buying your products. It's a game.
Children are not little adults. Their minds aren't developed. And what's happening is that marketers are playing to their developmental vulnerabilities. The advertising that children are exposed to today is honed by psychologists. It's enhanced by media technology that nobody ever thought was possible.
The more insight you have about the consumer, the more creative you'll be in your communication strategies. So if that takes a psychologist, yeah, we want one of those on staff.
I'm not saying that it's wrong to make things for children. You know, and I also think it's important to distinguish between psychologists who work on products for children, who help, you know, toy corporations make toys that are developmentally appropriate. I think that's great. That's different from selling the toys directly to the children.
Initiative is huge. I think in the U.S. we place about $12 billion of media time. So we'll put it on TV, we'll put it in print, we'll put it out in outdoor, we'll buy radio time. So we're the biggest buyers of advertising time and space in the U.S. and in the world.
One family cannot combat an industry that spends $12 billion a year trying to get their children. They can't do it.
They are tomorrow's adult consumers, so start talking with them now, build that relationship when they're younger, and you've got them as an adult. Somebody asked me, Lucy, is that ethical? You're essentially manipulating these children. Well, yeah, is it ethical? I don't know. But our role at Initiative is to move products. And if we know you move products with a certain creative execution, place in a certain type of media vehicle, then we've done our job.
Here's a commercial. Does anybody remember this commercial? This was only a few years ago. I'm playing it without the sound because I'm going to play it with the sound here in a moment to stress the fact of how powerful the musical aspect is. And we're going to kind of switch gears into music here. Does anybody remember this commercial? Few people do. So here, I'll play it again with the music and see if anybody else remembers this same commercial. All right, I think that's good enough there. Does anybody remember it? Does anybody remember it who didn't remember it without the music? Yeah. This commercial was so huge that the car sold out. There was a waiting list to buy that car. And the band that came up with this song, the name of the band was Dirty Vegas, they were nobody. And all of a sudden, they went to the top, and they became this famous band just because of this commercial. So this is the power that music has, and I'm going to talk about music now because this is a very important point I think we need to understand. Aleister Crowley, do what thou wilt is the whole of the law under love. This was his motto. Basically, if it feels good, do it. Put together a system of magic that if ever combined with the power of music would be able to revolutionize the world. You see, music's been around for a very, very long time. It's been around since the beginning. It's been around since before the beginning. We know that the angels sang music and that it was created for a certain purpose, which we'll look at. What is this revolution that they're looking at? Look at this quote here from Jonathan Goldman in Healing Sounds, The Power of Harmonics. The use of music in sacred ceremonies and shamanic rituals has occurred since ancient times. It has recently been verified that sound can be used to affect and change our brain waves. The changes of these rates creates changes in consciousness. They're talking about that alpha state again there. Allowing mystical altered states to be induced. The relationship between occult wisdom and sound may at first be far removed, yet in the ancient mystery schools that were in Egypt and Rome, Greece, Tibet, India, and other centers of learning, knowledge of sound was a highly refined science. All right, so this is something that's been known for a long time, that sound has this power to bring about mystical altered states of consciousness. Ellen White tells us in Patriarchs and Prophets, page 594, that music was made for a holy purpose, to lift the thoughts to that which is pure, noble, and elevating, to awaken in the soul devotion and gratitude towards God. This is what we should be looking for in our choice of music. She goes on to say, what a contrast between ancient custom and the uses to which music is now too often devoted. Thus, that which is a great blessing when rightly used becomes one of the most successful agencies by which Satan allures the mind from duty and from contemplation of eternal things. One of the most successful tools when used in the wrong way. Music forms a part of God's worship in the courts above, and we should endeavor in our songs of praise to approach as nearly as possible to the harmony of heaven. All right? Xu Qing, the great philosopher, said, for changing people's manners and altering their customs, there is nothing better than music. All right? Boetius, the famous Roman philosopher, 500 years after Christ, music is part of us. It either ennobles us or degrades our behavior. One of two things. There is no neutral plane when we're talking about music. It's either uplifting us or it's taking us down. Confucius, 500 years before Christ, if you want to know if a people are well governed and if their laws are good or bad, examine the music that it practices. Aristotle, music directly imitates the passions or state of the soul. When one listens to music that imitates a certain passion, he becomes imbued with that same passion. And if over a long time he habitually listens to the kind of music that arouses ignoble passions or negative passions, his whole character is shaped to an ignoble form. You see, music is the expression of emotion. That's why when we're in that rebellious stage in our life, I went through this stage in my life, you listen to music that sounds rebellious, that's dun-dun-dun-dun-dun, dun-dun-dun. All right? Got that angry feel to it because you're angry about something. And so you listen to the angry music. And the more you listen to it, the more angry you become. It's very powerful. Music is very, very powerful. Socrates, when modes of music change, the fundamental laws of the state always change with them. Think about the laws that are changing. I was just speaking with a man here before we started, he's from San Francisco, and talking about the laws that they've put into effect, over homosexuality, and you can't even speak against it now. Laws start to change when modes of music change, and there has been an unprecedented change in music in just the last 50 years. I mean, you look at Elvis Presley and the music that he came out with, and he was denounced from pulpits all over the country saying, hey, this is the devil's music, and now that's child's play. I mean, what if Metallica would have come out first? Or the Iron Maiden. I mean, people wouldn't have known what to do with it. David Crosby from the Crosby, Stills, and Nash told Rolling Stone magazine in 1981, I figured the only thing to do was to swipe their kids. I still think it's the only thing to do. But by saying this, I'm not talking about kidnapping. I'm just talking about changing the value system, which removes them from their parents' world very effectively. The rock and roll industry is also called the counterculture revolution. They're countering the culture and trying to revolutionize the value system. This country was based upon Christian values, and they're trying to turn that upside down on its head. Mick Jagger from the Rolling Stones, in the book The Secret Power of Music, says, we are moving after the minds, and so are most of the new groups. They know this. They know that if they can captivate the mind, they can change the way we think and the way we make decisions. In the hands of Satan, temptation has become a science. He is the god of this world because the world has chosen him as its master. In his temptations of our first parents, Satan could not force them to transgress. He could only suggest allurements to sin. And the mind that is open to his suggestions is the medium through which he works to allure other minds. It's only through people that Satan can get anything done. And your mind opens in these ways that we're talking about. Hypnosis is opening that part of your mind that is meant for a certain purpose. Music does the same thing. There are three categories in music. Now, this gets a little touchy when you start talking about music. I think there's a couple of things that you got to be careful with. You don't want to touch someone's plate, right? Don't mess with what I'm eating. You got to be very careful when you're talking about the health laws and dietary issues. I think you need to be equally as careful when you're talking about music. It is a very personal thing, and we each need to choose on our own what is right and what is wrong, and we need to prayerfully do that. Amen. The three categories, and they affect us all in the same way, regardless of race, regardless of your customs and background, these three things affect us all in the same way. When you listen to music that emphasizes melody, we listen with that part of our brain that is more concerned with the aesthetic, with the emotional, with the spiritual. You're listening with the spiritual side of your brain when you listen to melody. Harmony, because of the complexity of harmony, you listen with the more intellectual part of your brain. And the third category is rhythm. rhythm, you listen with, or it creates a physical response in the human organism. Okay? And all three of these things are in all music. I'm not saying that rhythm is bad. It's how it's used. So I'm going to kind of focus a little bit on this third category here, rhythm. When you accentuate rhythm, what happens when you accentuate rhythm? When you bring rhythm to the forefront and it's at the level of monotony. Remember, one of the fundamental key principles of hypnosis is monotony. You're staring at a flashing light. You're listening to repetitious instructions. Same thing happens when you listen to a repetitious beat that's at the forefront. When the beat's going, just like in those commercials we just heard. It brings about a physical response in the human organism. That's why people dance. Anywhere a beat is emphasized. You can't do anything else but dance. You'll eventually start nodding your head or tapping your foot or something, or possibly get up and start dancing. So, question here. How far back does the history of modern popular music go? And what modes of music can we put into the present popular music category? So I'm going to lump all these styles of music together now, and they are all lumped together over this same fundamental element that they all use, a monotonous, repetitious, syncopated beat. Okay? Blues, jazz, rock and roll, country, rock, metal, thrash, punk, house music, rap, rave, techno, calypso, reggae, whatever you want to call it. Any style of music that accentuates beat to the point of repetitious monotony, they all share this common element. And they have a vital link to the ancient past, which ties them all together. So what is that vital link that they all share? It's that very thing. They have this repetitious, monotonous, syncopated beat. Syncopation in itself is not bad. It's how it's used. Syncopation happens in all styles of music. It's when an accent in music happens on the offbeat. It syncopates. But when it is syncopated at the level of monotony, this is where we get into trouble. The worship aspect. Sun worship dates all the way back to Nimrod. Remember Nimrod and Semiramis? Nimrod's the one who started the building of the Tower of Babel. Nimrod and Semiramis, when Nimrod died, Semiramis said that he went up to the sun, and later on she was impregnated by the sun, and she gave birth to the sun god Tammuz. Okay? This is where sun worship began. And it is a link that links all systems of pagan worship together. There's sun worship in all of them. There's elements of sun worship in each one. So how did pagan sun worship become integrated into our modern music forms? It was through the drum. And again, the drum is not an evil instrument in and of itself. Please don't misunderstand me on that. It's how it is used. All right? The stretched skin over the drum represents the tightly stretched stomach of the mother about to give birth to the sun god. Okay, so there's the sun aspect coming in. The drum is the symbol of the sun god. The African drums are considered to be sacred. They are washed, they're put to rest, and they are worshipped as deities. The belief is that the drums are the ears of the gods and that they must be played with the attitude that you are speaking to the gods on behalf of humanity. Okay, so what is this drumming thing all about? And that comes from Hear the Long Snake Moan by Michael Ventura. So I want to talk about voodoo just for a little bit here, okay? And voodoo, it was called Vodun. A lot of people equate voodoo with Africa. It was actually called Vodun worship in Africa, and it wasn't until it came to Haiti and Santo Domingo and other places in the Caribbean that it was actually coined. It came to be known as voodoo. The follower of voodoo seeks to incorporate a loa, a lesser god, into himself by writhing and leaping through a dance while drums bang out complex rhythms. When just the right rhythm is found for a certain individual lesser god, the dancer takes it up and the lesser god enters his soul. His physical and mental powers are immediately heightened, and he becomes godlike himself. Notice the lingo there. Animals will often be sacrificed to appease the spirits. The religion is strictly Dionysian. It is sensual and unrestrained, and the dances often end in wholesale copulation. It ends in an orgy. Okay? There's three main things that were always present at a pagan system of worship ceremony, from Baal to Ashtoreth to Dagon, whatever you would, all those, okay? And I'll just use the modern form of it. The rock and roll industry calls it sex, drugs, and rock and roll, right? You have the sexual aspect, ending in orgy there. Drugs. The drugs bring about that heightened state of suggestibility. They bring about that altered state of consciousness and rhythmical dancing or drumming. Each percussive or vocal part has a slightly different rhythm, which coincides with and sometimes crosses the other rhythms or the guiding pulse. At strategic moments, the drummers often shuffle their feet and sway their bodies in a dance-like motion to assist them in maintaining contact with the main beat, especially when the rhythm is syncopated. During these rituals that still take place in the Congo and Yoruba land and everywhere else in the world, the intricate layers of the multiple rhythmic drumming are considered a source of occult power. That's an important point there, okay? Because remember, it's through the drumming that they believe that the spirits would come into them. And that they have, there's this crossroads aspect. The tribal people's religious worship is seen as a bodily celebration. It's something that they experience physically. This is why the rhythm and the beat in their worship music is so accentuated. Remember, when you accentuate rhythm to the point of monotony, the response is a physical one. Look at this quote here from Jimi Hendrix. Okay, he was very much into voodoo. He wrote a song called Voodoo Child. He said, "We are making our music into electric church music, a new kind of Bible. A Bible you carry around in your hearts, one that will give you a physical feeling. We try to make our music so loose and hard-hitting that it hits your soul hard enough to make it open. We want them to realize that our music is just as spiritual as going to church." We're talking about a religion here. All right? He goes on to say, atmospheres are going to come through music because music is a spiritual thing of its own. That's what it was created for. It's a spiritual thing. But in the hands of Lucifer, remember, it's something else. You can hypnotize people with music, and when you get them at their weakest point, at that point at which the guard is let down, at that point at which the heightened state of suggestibility is at its highest, you can preach into the subconscious what you want to say. What an admission. So, how did voodoo enter into our modern modes of music? Okay? The blues were the sounds that the slaves made because they weren't allowed to play their drums. And I'm not condoning the slave trade in any way when I say that the slave owners didn't allow them to practice their music. But they found other ways to incorporate these rhythms and elements of their voodoo ritual into music by the way they played the guitar, by the way they played any instrument, by the notes and the rhythms were all essentially there. Blues actually means blue devils, or a fit of bad temper or a melancholy feeling. A lot of times the subject matter of blues was sexual in nature, was about betrayal and cheating on one another and this and that. They were played in brothels and bars and places of concerns of the flesh. Let me just read this quote here. "The subject matter of blues often express betrayal, mistrust, perversion, and sexual desire. The sexual nature of many of the songs was deliberately veiled in African colloquialisms and terms. As a result, the listeners who heard the music could not understand the true nature of these songs." Here's a list of some of these terms that came out of this era that we still use today, and a lot of us don't realize, I didn't know what these words meant. The word funky. You heard the word funky? People use this word, kids use this word, they think it's a cool word, it's funky. But they don't understand really what the true meaning of the word is. The definition of funky is a strong smell or a sweat, often in connection with a sexual connotation. So it means to smell sexual, basically. Okay? Boogie, you've heard of boogie? The boogeyman, the spook, okay? This means to feel devilishly good. That's the definition of the term boogie. So someone might say, hey, let's play a funky beat. Let's get them dancing in that sexual way, and maybe they'll boogie. They'll feel devilishly good. The mojo. You've heard of the mojo? The mojo is the male sexual organ. Or the soul. They believed that the soul was in your sexual organ. So here, Jim Morrison, he wrote that song, Get Your Mojo Working. Now you know what he meant. The groove. Get into the groove. Madonna sings a song, Get Into the Groove, so that you can prove your love to me. The groove is the female sexual organ. Now you know what she meant. Juke. Juke was another term for the spirit or the devil. Okay? So here you have the juke box, or quite literally, the box with the devils in it. So see, all these terms were veiled and hidden, their true meaning was hidden so that their music would be accepted and that they could continue to practice their ritualistic thing. And this just became infiltrated into all forms of music. From the blues, we get jazz. The definition of jazz is the immoral act. That's what the word means. And from jazz, we get rock and roll and all our other styles of music that follow this same kind of thing. And rock and roll was an African-American expression for sex before it was ever a term for music. So how can we have Christian rock? We are taking something that is absolutely profane, and just because we think that we can attach the name of Jesus to it, it's now sanctified. Every style of music that we have out there in the world we have in the contemporary Christian scene. I mean, they have punk, they have thrash, they have heavy metal, all these things. You can go to a Christian punk concert and they do moshing just like they do at a regular punk concert. All the same activities. But just because we attach the name of Jesus to it, we think that we can use this. Look at what Joachim Berendt says in his book, the Jazz Book. Taking an active interest in jazz means to be working for a majority, because the popular music of our times feeds on jazz. All music, not just some here, all music we hear in TV series, on Top 40 radio, in hotel lobbies, on elevators, in commercials, and in movies, all music to which we dance, from Charleston to rock, from funk to disco, all those sounds that daily engulf us, all that music came from jazz, because beat came to the Western music through jazz, and jazz came from the blues, and blues came from voodoo. And voodoo goes all the way back. Santana, he has an album called Supernatural. Here's some quotes from Santana. These are kind of interesting. There's a sound vibration, a resonance, that rearranges our molecular structure to a point where your hair stands up. You feel like touching bodies, horny, all at the same time. It's a whole other kind of spirit. It's a physical experience that's taking place. This is what they're wanting. This is what it's all about. That was in Mojo Magazine, major industry magazine, 1999. He goes on to say, look at this. In my meditations, this entity called Methatron said, we want to hook you back up to the radio airwave frequency to reach junior high schools and universities. And once you reach them, we want elements. David Bowie, a lot of you know who David Bowie is. I believe rock and roll is dangerous. It could very well bring about an evil feeling in the West. It's got to go the other way now, and that's where I see it heading, bringing about the dark era. I feel that we are only heralding something even darker than ourselves. Rock and roll lets in lower elements and shadows. Rock has always been the devil's music, and you can't convince me that it isn't. This is a major industry rock and roll star saying this. He knows exactly what he's a part of and what he's doing. Rolling Stone's manager said, rock is sex. You have to hit teenagers in the face with it. Okay, this is targeting our youth. Trying to change the value system. Now I'm going to quote from people all over the industry here, okay? So that when you leave here, you can't say, hey, Tom Meyer said this. You have to say, these people in the industry said this, okay? Here's Duke Ellington, the famous Graz Jate. He said, rhythm came from Africa to America. Do you know what it does to you? Exactly what it's supposed to do. It's kind of an ominous statement, but he knows exactly what it's supposed to do to you. In the Life and Times of Little Richard, okay, everybody knows who Little Richard is. He's the king of rock, okay? A lot of people say Elvis Presley was, but he wasn't. It's Little Richard. My belief about rock and roll, my true belief about rock and roll, and there have been a lot of phrases attributed to me over the years, is this. I believe this kind of music is demonic. A lot of beats in music today are taken from voodoo, from the voodoo drums. If you study music and rhythms like I have, you'll see that it's true. Okay? He knows. They know. And they're not hiding it. They're not trying to hide it. It glares at us on every industry magazine, everywhere. It's all about sex, 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 sex. John Lennon of the Beatles. Rock and roll is primitive and has no bull. It gets through to you. Its beats come from the jungle. They have rhythm. He knew what he was doing. Industry manager Malcolm McLaren, one of the biggest managers in rock and roll, said that rock and roll is pagan and primitive and very jungle. And that's how it should be. The moment it stops being those things, it's dead. The true meaning of rock is sex, subversion, and style. Sinead O'Connor, talking about hip-hop and rap. Hip-hop and rap is the most powerful form of music communication. It's very spiritual. It's got so many messages within its rhythms, within the drum beats, as well as the words. People don't realize how powerful hip-hop is musically. Music is the most powerful form of communication. Talking about the rave culture, Nicholas Saunders, one big promoter of the rave culture. What fascinates me is what the rave culture is that the rave culture, seen as purely hedonistic by the establishment, by the church, is frequently regarded as a spiritual event by those involved. Ravers are likened to trance-like tribal rituals where ravers celebrate their unity and their shared uplifted state, giving and receiving freely from one another. See, all those same elements are there. The uplifted state, that's that altered state of consciousness brought about by the music and enhanced by the drugs. Giving and receiving freely from one another. There's the sexual aspect coming in. Trance music is currently exploding in the techno mainstream, but it has existed since man could first whack a drum. It's about feeling, euphoria, and spontaneous levitation of the senses through repetition and organic sounds. Now having mated with the sleek sounds of sleek machines of techno, it's all about the future. Robert Palmer in Rolling Stone magazine, Illustrated History of Rock and Roll, said, in a very real sense, rock was implicit in the music of the first Africans brought to North America. And implicit in their music were centuries of accumulated rites, rituals, and religious fervor. It's a religion that's coming through this music. And all this music is the backbone to all these things that we watch in television and on TV and everything. It's there. That musical aspect is there. It's not just an exaggeration to say that rebellion is more than just an occasional theme in rock. It is the very heart and soul. Rolling Stones magazine, 20th century, or 20th anniversary TV special, okay? Remember, this is the industry that is leading the rebellion against God. Rock and roll is an aggressive art form, pure hostility and aggression. I believe in that like a religion. Blackie Lawless of Wasp. I think you probably. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as the iniquity and idolatry. Okay? So if we have a rebellious attitude, it's as the sin of witchcraft. And witchcraft brings about rebellion. It just kind of perpetuates itself. Remember, the mind is the only thing that God communicates to us with. And if we're not protecting and guarding against, putting up hedges and guarding these avenues to which get to, right to our souls, you have no defense. You have no defense. I know this from a personal experience. I listened to all these types of music. I watched every movie that came out. Didn't matter what rating it was. And eventually, that manifested in my life a rebellion against God. Period. I left the church. I didn't stop reading my Bible, stop praying. And you know what? It's like even now I'm struggling with coming. Just because I've come back doesn't mean it's all easy. I'm still struggling with these things because of the years of implanted things that I've put into my mind. I've literally damaged part of my mind probably. And I've been praying, God, please, you know, create in me a new spirit. Heal my mind. And I believe he's been doing that. And I believe he'll do that to anybody who asks. Hey, God is more powerful than all this stuff. So, you know, I don't want anybody to go away discouraged or like, oh man, it's all around me. It's everywhere. I can't even walk into the grocery store. But, you know, it's true. It is. It's everywhere. But when we have God with us, when we have that supernatural power that is the Holy Spirit, we can withstand anything. You know, I think, you know, Ivor talks a lot about, you know, entering into this faith world, right? We only enter into this faith world through our minds. It's something that's unseen. And we can only do that when we're sitting there praying and we're asking God, please let me, you know, hear your voice. Let us bow our heads and pray. Dear Lord, please be with us in a mighty way. Help us to understand how to guard well the avenues to our soul. And thank you so much for the things that you have revealed to my brother and Brandon and I, and that we've been given the opportunity to come here and speak to these people. Send your Holy Spirit to be with us and to guide us in all our decisions, and that you are the masters of our minds, and that your thoughts will be our thoughts, and your words will be our words. In Jesus' name, amen.